Well, it's good to see the house of the Lord tonight on this Tuesday night. And just thank God for the opportunity that we have to be in the Lord's house this evening. I like that song, Jesus, what a wonderful name. I will say this, you can mention Brother Joe, you can say Chris, you can say Leo, Bob, Sam, or Sue. We won't do a whole lot. When you mention that name, Jesus, there is something the songwriter said about that name. Amen. Joy to have you with us in Jubilee tonight. Don't forget now, service is tomorrow night at 7:30, then on Thursday night at 7:30, Friday night at 7:30. But don't forget also, several of our people taking vacation. Some will be with us. But Friday morning, 10 a.m., we have service, and we're looking forward to a great, great time in the Lord on Friday morning. So don't forget that. Then we'll have lunch to follow, and we're looking forward. Brother Jeremy Chisholm to be one of our preachers. Young men, you have not heard, pastors down in Travelers Rest, good preacher, great church, and he'll be with us Thursday night, new preacher for here at Calvary. We're going to have Brother Tommy Turner's going to be with us. Man, I just about lost my train of thought. Brother Tommy Turner's going to be with us on Thursday night. You're going to enjoy Brother Turner. Pastors of great Bible Baptist Church in Landrum, South Carolina. I preached there the last 3 years. I'm going to tell you what. When you go there, they go to church with you. And so we're going to have a good time. Matter of fact, that's probably the place I was preaching at when I talked to the Parquet family about coming here to Calvary and Hispanic work and mission boards. We praise the Lord for what God's doing there. And they'll be here on Thursday. Brother Tommy Weiss bringing some folks in a bus with him Thursday night. Then on Friday night, one of my favorite preachers in this country, Dr. Kenny Kuykendall, author, pastor, preacher across this country, is going to be with us. I have the privilege of serving with him on executive board of Macedonia World Baptist Missions. Got a heart for missions. And Brother Kuykendall will be here Friday night, and we're excited about that as well. And so I hope you can be with us each and every night. I know if you're visiting tonight, you'll be in your church tomorrow night, and that'll be great, and you should do that, but I trust that you can be with us, and we'll have a good time in the Lord. I'm going to get the ushers to come on up if you would, and I want them to come up, and we're going to see our offering. I want to mention this, that everything you give during this week goes to the expense of the meeting. And so if you'd like to help us with that, be a blessing. That'd be really encouraging. If you have it, you give it. If you don't worry about it. I know God's going to meet the need. It's good to have the long-time associate pastor of Calvary Baptist Church here in Statesville. He's on staff with me, I guess, for close to 12 years. And it's good to have Brother Hensley with us tonight. Pastor Wiggins Road Baptist Church. Brother Honey, I want you to make your way up here, please, sir. I want you to lead us in prayer tonight. Ask the Lord touch the service. We enjoy to have he and Miss Lori with us tonight. And Macy, I think Macy's grown a little bit. Miss Lori's same height. But it's good to have them in the service with us tonight. Preacher, thank you for coming on a Tuesday night. Appreciate you being with us. And would you open us up and ask God to bless us all? Thank you.
Let's pray. Lord, we love you. We thank you for the opportunity to be in your house tonight. Thank you for all your many blessings, everything you've done for us. Lord, I pray you bless the service now tonight. I pray you touch the man of God as he'll preach tonight. God, help us to have receptive hearts to what you'd say to us tonight. Just being the Jubilee this week, Lord, I pray you bless this church. God, help them to continue to go forward for you. Well, thank you and praise you for what you do. In Christ's name we do pray. Amen.
Right before they take off, Brother Harry, just tell us a minute about the meeting you got coming up so folks here know about it and come over if you would do that.
Yeah, we'll be having a revival. It'll start on Sunday night. We'll be there for that. But Monday through Thursday will be the 26th through the 30th of this month. My dad's going to be preaching for us. If you've never heard of him, some of you, a bunch of you here have heard him, I know. So come down and be with us. We'd love to have you 7:30 each night.
Thank you, Brother Harry. I'm going to be preaching down Travelers Rest that week, so y'all go down and support them, all right? And I pray God will give them a good meeting down there. Brother Hensley, just let it fly. Amen? I promise you he'll preach to you. I promise you that. All right? Okay, Brother Jimmy.
Hymn number 318. My sins are gone.
Thank you.
boy is crying, 'cause he's scared of dying. But with morning's light, he finds he's alright. Because of the blood placed over the door, my sin debt is paid, I'm not afraid anymore. The Lamb has been slain.
Thank you.
still to this day trying to think, how could have ever loved me so? Amen. Let's all stand together, Brother Joe. You come tonight, preach to us what God's put on your heart. Look for the message tonight. Grab your Bible and listen to the man of God.
Thank you, Pastor. You may be seated tonight. Hebrews chapter number 2 in your Bible. I appreciate the good songs tonight. Jesus, what a wonderful name.
Amen.
Our choir does that. I might want to run every time.
Amen.
And I'll always do it on Sunday morning when I'm in my dignified mood.
Amen.
I love that. Love the good specials tonight. How could Jesus ever love us?
Amen.
All the way I can think of it. He's a sovereign God. He willed it that way.
Amen.
And I appreciate the goodness of the Lord. If you're saved tonight, raise your right hand. If you know it, raise your left hand. If you're glad about it, raise both of them. Keep them up. Now turn around with somebody, put their hands up and say, I told you you was going to shout one of these days. You say, you tricked me. Well, it worked, praise God. Now, man, you don't want to miss the rest of this meeting this week. Tomorrow night, a flaming torch from Asheville will be preaching. Our people love Brother David because he don't preach long. That's what they like about him. We hosted an event not long ago, and one of the preachers that the event set over preached for 1 hour and 45 minutes. Now, the first 30 minutes was really good. Second 30 minutes was okay. So the last 45 minutes was excruciating. One of my ladies, I've been her pastor probably 30 years, she came up to me and she said, I will never, ever say anything to you again about how long you preach. I said, don't lie. Next Sunday, she's right back at it again. But anyway, they love Brother David, and then, of course, Brother Turner, a great man of God. And then Brother Kuykendall, what a preacher he is. And I appreciate y'all putting up with me last night and tonight. I love your pastor. We go back a long way. I'm talking a long, long way. We both had hair, and we both were young. But now we are mature and blessed. We used to be hunks. Now we're chunks. But I appreciate him so very much. Good to be Brother Crabtree again. I appreciate him in the Lord. People like him make me sick. I don't like skinny people. You know why most skinny people are hateful? They're hungry. And then this young man over here. Boy, to be that size again. Son, I wish I could pull off that bow tie. But as fat as I am, I look like the doughboy with a tie around his neck. You know? But I appreciate it tonight. Turn to the person sitting beside of you and say, Jesus loves you, and I'm trying to. I did that in Alabama one night, and a fellow really done that to his wife, and she went, what? The Lord is good. If you love the Lord tonight, say amen.
Amen.
Hebrews chapter number 2 tonight, we'll begin reading in verse number 1. Hebrews chapter 2, verse number 1, therefore. Now, anytime you read the word therefore, you need to go to the verses before that and see what it's there for. Well, what do you have there for? Chapter 1, he talks about how wonderful Christ is. How that he is better than Moses, and better than the prophets, and better than the angels. How that he is above all and he is all. Christ is everything. He's everything that he claimed to be and a whole lot more. He is our Savior. He is our mediator. He is the one that God has chosen to spoke to mankind and revealed his love. God revealed himself in the Old Testament through the tabernacle, but God reveals himself now through Jesus Christ, the personification of the glory of God. He is our founder, our Savior, our Lord, our God, and therefore, because Jesus is wonderful, Jesus is great, therefore, we ought to give the more earnest heed to the things which we have heard. What have we heard? We have heard that Jesus is great. Jesus is wonderful. He is better than the best, higher than the highest, greater than the greatest. And once we hear the message of Jesus, we are responsible for what we do with that message. Therefore, we ought to give the more earnest heed to the things which we have heard, lest at any time we should let them slip. Let me say this tonight, of all the things in life you don't want to forget. You don't want to forget Jesus. What a wonderful name. Of all the things in life that's passed by your mind, of all things you need to grab a hold of tonight, and that is Jesus is wonderful. Jesus is great. Jesus is God. Jesus is all in all. Don't let that slip. Notice what he said in verse number 2. For if the word spoken by angels was steadfast, and every transgression and disobedience received a just recompense of reward. You say, Brother Joe, what is he saying right there? He is saying nobody up to us has ever gotten by forgetting that, and we're not going to get by forgetting that. Watch what he says now in verse number 3. How shall, say this word with me, we. Notice the writer did not say how shall you or how shall they. He said how shall we.
Right.
Five times in these verses he uses that powerful personal word we. That tells me something like the writer is not talking to the lost. He is not talking to the heathen. He is talking to those that have been saved and have received this wonderful Jesus. How shall we escape if we neglect so great salvation? Say that with me again. How shall we escape if we neglect so great salvation? Can I tell you tonight, salvation is salvation. Can I tell you tonight that salvation is great salvation? But can I tell you tonight that salvation is so great in salvation? You say, what's so great about it? Well, you need it so great. God bought it so great. The Bible taught it so great. And the Holy Ghost wrought it so great. And we ought to live it and shout it and proclaim it so great. That because we have trusted Jesus Christ, we can claim we have so great salvation. And notice what he says in the text tonight. How shall we escape if we neglect so great of salvation? He is talking to you and I that are already saved. He is not talking about neglecting the opportunity of salvation. He is talking about neglecting the obligation of salvation.
Right.
He is not talking about neglecting to be saved at all. He is talking about neglecting the salvation that we already have. Remember that. He's talking about neglecting the salvation that we already have. I wonder if there's anybody in this building tonight saved and knowing and glad about it.
Amen.
Therefore, you are responsible not to ignore and neglect, but grow in the grace of God and build your faith and nurture your faith and not neglect the salvation that you already have. You see, there is a principle in the Bible where there is great blessing, there is also great responsibility. You remember in the book of Genesis when God put Adam and Eve in the garden, he blessed them with the liberty to eat of the fruit of those trees, everyone except one little tree. And that's the one that God says you're not supposed to have. And that's the very one they wanted. And may I add tonight, they got what they wanted, but they lost what they had. For where there's great blessing, there is great responsibility. There's a principle in the Bible, who much is given, much is required. You take somebody that goes to a liberal church, they never hear truth, they never hear the Word of God. They're not supposed to be as spiritual as you are because they've not had the opportunity to do so. But somebody like you tonight that goes to a church, not just during Jubilee, but every Sunday morning and every Sunday night and every Wednesday night, truth and the Bible and life comes across this pulpit, most of us in this room tonight have already heard more preaching than we really have grace to live up to for the rest of our life. Where there's great blessing, there's great responsibility. You think about this tonight. Marriage is a blessing. Well, let me stop and say it's intended to be a blessing. I am so glad that God ordained that a man marry a woman. And it is a blessing. When a man and a woman fall in love, pledge heart and hand, sign that contract for life, man, it is a blessing. I'm glad I'm not alone. I'm glad the Lord has blessed me with a wonderful wife and she's still alive and I love her with all my heart. Marriage is a real blessing. But there comes responsibility with that blessing. When you stood before the preacher and you stood before God, in essence, this is what you said. I am leaving all others and I'm cleaving to this one till death do us part. Now that is a great responsibility. Having children are a blessing. I have enjoyed being a daddy. I've heard other preachers brag about, you know, well, I'm not a family man. Well, I wouldn't brag about that. I have enjoyed having children. You know what I've enjoyed about having children? Somebody in my house has got to do what I say to do. You say, what about that other person that's lived in your house? We'll preach on Ephesians 5 tomorrow. Children are a blessing. If you have a daughter, you know exactly what I'm talking about. On the pinky of every daddy, oh, is a little ring that says, Daddy, you do what daughter wants to do. I made those brags about, bless God, I'm a... You just shut up. Because when she looks at you with them baby blues and says, Daddy. Boy, there's a certain quiver in that voice, Daddy. That's why all daddies ought to have a gun collection. So when Trooper Drawers comes over to want to date darling, you show him your hobby. Show him your deer heads and say, son, you're the next monument to my marksmanship hanging on that wall. Children are a blessing. It is a great blessing. I saw this man a while ago singing with his children. What a blessing. Children are a blessing. But wait a minute. What an awesome responsibility. Because the Bible said as arrows are in the hands of a mighty man, so are children among the youth. Where there's great blessing, there is great responsibility. Driving an automobile is a great blessing. I mean, even if you have to drive a Dodge, driving an automobile is a blessing. Everybody's not privileged to drive a Chevrolet, but you know, some people have to struggle in life. But man, driving an automobile is a great blessing. I'm glad I don't have to walk everywhere I go. Fat people are not designed to walk, we're designed to drive. My friend Brother Phil Kidd was at a stoplight the other day and two woman missionaries came out of the bicycles and he rolled down the window and said, boys, if y'all get saved, be a Baptist preacher, you can ride in a Cadillac. Say amen. I'm glad to ride in an automobile. It is a great, great blessing. I'm glad I get to ride. I'm glad it is a blessing. But there's also great responsibility. You can kill yourself with that thing. You can kill others with that thing. Because where there's great blessing, there's great responsibility. I should all that to say this. I believe tonight that being saved by the grace of God, washed from the blood of Jesus, saved from hell, is a blessing. If God never does nothing else but save our soul, change our past, emancipate us from the chains of sin, write our name in the last book of life, fill us with His Holy Spirit, and give us joy and peace and blessing and anointing, and on top of that, a home in heaven and an escape from hell. My, oh my, what a blessing salvation is. Amen. It is a blessing to have your sins forgiven. It is a blessing to have your past erased. It is a blessing to be spirit baptized into the body of Christ. It is a blessing to be adopted. adopted as a child of God. It is a blessing to have Jesus as your Savior, and God is your Father, and the Holy Ghost as your comforter, and the Bible is your book, and heaven is your home. Sign, seal, I mean, on my way to heaven. It don't get any better than that. It is a blessing. Have access to God. To be able to say, Our Father, which art in heaven. To be able to stand and say, I have been justified. I'm being sanctified. And one day by the blood of Christ, I will be glorified. Hallelujah, what I say. Being saved is a blessing. But can I remind you tonight, where there's great blessing, there is great responsibility. Can I tell you tonight that God didn't send Jesus Christ on the cross and endure the shame and shed His blood to save your soul for you to come to a church and sit and sour and soak? God didn't bankrupt heaven to save you from the devil's hell for you to never mature and add to your faith and grow in the grace and the knowledge of Jesus Christ. God did not send His Son all the way from the outer palaces of glory to a sin-cursed world for you not to know any more about Him 40 years after your decision than you did the night you trusted Christ. He has blessed us with salvation. He has honored us with salvation. And we have a responsibility to live like we're saved, act like we're saved, grow like we're saved, praise like we're saved, serve like we're saved, grow in grace, mature your faith, build on your faith. Don't neglect the salvation that you already have. I've got some people in my church that were saved out of a life of deep, terrible sin. Boy, that was a definite, radical, I mean dramatic change in their life when they got saved. And it's so powerful that sometimes it becomes a burden because they're quick to judge others who don't live for God like they should and walk with God like they should. And they say, well, they just didn't get it. They just didn't get it. They just didn't get it. I believe more people got saved than we really want to admit. Because, by the way, getting saved is not hard to do. Someone said, do you believe or you preach against easy belief? Listen, it is not hard to get saved. Getting lost is the hard part. Swallowing your stinking pride is the hard part. Realizing you need a Savior is the hard part. You ever get that part behind you? Believing and trusting the Word of Jesus Christ and the finished work of Christ upon the cross. It's not hard to do, brother. I am not a Calvinist. I'm not a hyper. I'm not an above. I'm not a below. I believe that salvation comes when you call upon Jesus and believe on Christ and trust Him as your Savior. For the Bible said He came into His own, and His own received Him not. But to as many, oh I love that, but to as many as received Him, that then gave Him power to become the sons of God. My God, I feel like preaching like that. Even to them that believe on His name. Or you say, preacher, out of everybody that came to the altar tonight, how many of them really got saved? I'll be how many of them really got saved? Every last one of them that signed with God against themselves and trusted Jesus and claimed the blood. Everyone that believed in Christ and trusted Him, they got saved. That's what the Bible says. You say, what happens to people who claim they get saved and they fall by the way and they don't grow in the grace of God? What I'm preaching on tonight, they neglected the salvation that they already have. He's not dealing with the opportunity of salvation. He is dealing with the obligation of salvation. We are not our own, for we have been bought with a price. If you're a child of the King, then live like a child of the King. If God has saved your soul, then you live like God has saved your soul. Now that God has forgiven you and redeemed you and restored you and given you a new lease on life, we of all people ought to love Him and praise Him and walk with Him and adore Him and serve Him. We ought to be so thankful that we're not going to hell tonight, that serving God and living for Jesus ought to be our Romans chapter 12, our reasonable serving. I was riding down the road the other day, a back passage. I mean, just ignited in my soul. I got to waving at people and praising God, and everybody got to waving back at me. That guy that pulled me over with that little stinking blue light, he wasn't as spiritual as I was. I shared that nugget with him, and he was not impressed. Oh, I got so blessed. Think about what he said. I beseech you, therefore, brethren, talking to save you, by the mercies of God. Every time God asks you and I to live right, walk right, serve God, He does that on the basis of the mercies of God. I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable unto God. And He says, which is your reasonable service. Can I put that in plain old Georgia and North Carolina language? After God gave you mercy and not justice, the least we ought to be able to do is serve the Lord. After God saved our soul from hell, emancipated us from the chains of sin, wiped our slate clean, justified us by His blood, hell moved out, 7 acres of heaven moved in, wrote our name in the last book of life, built a mansion in glory, our advocate at the right hand of God the Father, coming back in fire and great glory. Heaven is my home. I couldn't go to hell if I wanted to. I've even been told to, and I say I can't. I've been washed in the blood, sealed by the Spirit. Oh, my Lord, to heaven. You're a man that's blessed and happy and justified, but it's the least I can do. God saved my soul, changed my life. I love it. Pastor. There's usually something deep coming after that. And it's usually, well, you'll get that after a while. My daughter Joanna says her new book's going to be Preacher. Well, I love it. Pastor, can I speak with you after the service in your office? I need counsel. Yeah, come on into Dr. Jones' office. Are you ready for the counsel? And boy, I listen and I say, okay, are you ready? Number one, go to church. Number two, read your Bible. Number three, tithe. I've never seen a person go bankrupt who tithes. Go to church, read your Bible, tithe, pray. Witness. And of course, in our church, I had shout. They say, is that all? I come for great wisdom, Dr. Arthur. Okay, you ready? Go to church. Read your Bible. Pray. Witness. Tithe. Shout. You say, does that cure all problems? No, but it'll help you get started on your way to recovery. I'm telling you, reading your Bible is the least you can do. Go to church is the least you can do. Pray. The least you can do. Tithe is the least you can do. And shout is the least you can do. I'm telling you, God saved us. The blood saved us. Jesus died for us. Living He justified. I'm telling you, to be saved is a blessing. We ought to praise Him, love Him, serve Him, grow in the grace of God, build on our faith. Don't neglect the salvation that we already have. Don't neglect it. Don't put it aside. Don't put it on the back shelf. But make it the main goal in your life to be what God wants you to be and go where God wants you to go. If you are King's kid, then live like a child of the King. Notice what he said in our text, how shall we escape? Escape, the little word there means something that is unavoidable. You know, tonight to supply this to a lost person. If they neglect the opportunity to be saved and they turn God away, they will not be able to escape the flames of hell. Only Jesus can satisfy the soul. But a person that already has salvation, if they neglect that, don't grow that, don't mature that, and don't put that a priority in their life, there are some things also, according to the Bible, that is unavoidable to them. You say, what is it, preacher? If I neglect the salvation that I already have, what is so bad? What is so unavoidable in my life? Well, according to the book of Hebrews, number one, listen to this. I love this. A life of spiritual growth is unavoidable. Let me say it like this. If you neglect the salvation that you already have, you will be plagued with spiritual immaturity your entire Christian life. And let me say this. I believe one of the shams of our day is people that sit in our churches. They're no closer to God today. They don't know any more about God today. They don't know any more about the Bible today than they did. They was a sinner and they trusted Christ. We are to grow in the grace of God and mature our faith and build our faith. Don't limit your spiritual growth by neglecting your salvation. Don't be plagued with spiritual immaturity your entire Christian life. Let me say it like this tonight. I've been pastoring the same church almost 31 years. Same people, same church, 31 years. And 99.9% of the problems our church has ever experienced, you can find somebody in the middle of it, stirring it up, adding it on, who are plagued with spiritual immaturity. If they were mature in Christ, they wouldn't have said that. They wouldn't have acted like that. They would have participated in that. And the devil took advantage of them because they're still babes in Christ. I like babes in Christ. But we're not to stay babes. I have two children. You old timers that, you know, your wife was having the baby and y'all got to wait in the weight room and pass out cigars with your buddies. Hey, my generation, we don't have that privilege. We have to go back there. Well, if you've ever been back there, you know you've been back there. If you make it from back there, you don't want to go back there. And when you get back from back there, you thank God you ain't the one that's back there. Now, I don't know how babies were born in North Carolina. Both of mine were born in the state of Georgia. But I know one thing. My babies were born naked. I thought two nudist people had joined our family. They would fight you to put clothes on them. You turn your back, the clothes were gone. I don't know how babies were born in North Carolina, but mine were born without any teeth. I took my son to the steakhouse when he was 4 days old. He didn't enjoy it at all. Born without any teeth. It must run in our family. Both of my children, both son and daughter, were born bald-headed. When you see somebody that's bald, you know what we're doing? We're going back to our childhood, man. David, you going way back to your childhood. You done back down to the shiny stage on top. Somebody cover that dome up over there. I don't know how your kids were born, but mine were born. They couldn't even carry on an intelligent conversation. In fact, I've met some 17 and 18 year olds today. Still can't carry on a conversation. What's your name? Where you go to school? Come on now. I mean, mine were born. They couldn't read. They couldn't write. They couldn't speak. I tell you what I've done. About a week into that, I thought about calling the doctor up and saying, take them back. They can't do nothing. We had to feed them. We had to change them. See, all these baby pictures that these grandmas or grandpas carry around, they're deceiving. Old Papa said, look at here. They don't show you Pawpaw opening the night, changing diapers. Pawpaws don't do that. They just feed them cotton candy and Coca-Cola and jack them up and send them home with you and go, come on now. Oh, I almost called the hospital and I said, you give me the wrong babies. I'm a college graduate. My wife is a college graduate. We have college degrees. You give us dumb kids. They can't walk. They can't talk. They use the bathroom in their pants. They can't feed themselves. They can't change it. Man, you gave us the dumb babies. Said it to my wife. I said, I think they mixed them up. She said, Joe, look at the nose on their face. They're yours. I started to say, look how dumb they are, and they're yours. Well, I've learned, shut up. I'll tell you another waste of $40 is in stupid Lamaze breathing classes. That's a waste of money and time. I paid my $40 and I got my little dummy. Not my wife now, but I got my little dummy. And we went in there and all that. And I learned all that. Boy, that day came and we got her back there in that room. And I'm saying, now breathe. She said, you shut your stinking mouth. I said, now baby, because she said, shut up and get out of here. I said, make up your mind. You won't be in here. Shut up. And let me say this for all you old timers that married the real quiet and submissive women. Pray for the rest of us. I was preaching one time on a quiet, meek, submissive wife. A little young preacher come up to me. He said, glory to God, Dr. Arthur. That's the kind of wife I'm looking for. I said, well, let me give you some information, son. In our day, women like that are like parking spaces. They're either taken or handicapped. Can I get a message? It ain't happening. I told my wife, I said, we got the wrong babies. We got the wrong babies. Bring them back. They can't walk. They can't talk. They can't do anything. But you know what? My son is 27 and my girl's 25. Guess what? They got teeth. Guess what? They got hair. Guess what? They can talk. My daughter's a lawyer. You know she runs her mouth. Man, they eat and they don't use the bathroom in their pants, I hope. They turned out to be pretty good, respectable adults. Man, I'm glad I didn't take them back. I'm glad I didn't trade them in. It just took some time and some patience and some time and some patience and some time and some patience. Let me encourage you, church, when God sweeps through and saves a bunch of newborn babies, give them time and patience, time and patience, time and patience. God knows how to do His work if they'll grow in the grace of God. But tonight, my son is 27 and my girl is 25. If they still acted, talked, and tried to walk like they did when they were 6 weeks old or 6 months old, Houston, we got us a problem. Oh, I'm glad I didn't take them back. They've been the joy of my life. Man, I can hardly wait till they bless me with some grandbabies. It's got to be awesome. You know what I want to have grandbabies for? So you take time out of your schedule to look at my pictures this time. I'm going to warn you, it's different. You have a book. I have an iPad. You have 12 pictures. I got 12 million babies. Yes, sure. Man, I just can't hardly wait. Man, I'm glad I didn't take them back. You say, what's the difference? They grew up. They matured. I'm telling you, I see people all my ministry, in the church I pastor, in the churches I preach. Hey, Brother Joe, the Lord saved me 40 years ago. Praise God, I've been in the way 40 years. And they still have no faith. And they still have no victory. And they still have no peace. And they still have no joy. They still have no anointing of God upon their life. Paul said to the church at Corinth, when I was a child, I spake as a child, I acted like a child, but when I became a man, I put away childish things. Let me say, if you go to a good church where the Bible is preached, there is no excuse for spiritual immaturity. There is no excuse for spiritual immaturity. Am I telling it right? There is no excuse for spiritual immaturity. But grow in the grace of God. Get on the meat of the Word of God. Walk with God. Live for God. Let God fill with the Holy Spirit. nation, but pray and witness and study and grow and dive in with God and let God fill you with the power of God and enjoy the abundant Christian life. Don't neglect the salvation you already have. You know what the results will be? A life of spiritual growth. Number two, write this down out according to the book of Hebrews. If we neglect our salvation, we cannot escape, listen to this, limited influence. Limited influence. Let me say it like this tonight. If you don't grow in the grace of God, you won't have a testimony for God. And I heard this about all I want to hear. Well, Brother Joe, the Lord knows what's in my heart. Well, can I tell you this? You're not trying to win Jesus to Christ.
Right.
The Lord's already saved. You're not trying to convince Jesus to turn from the false religions to this world. He is the way, the truth, and the life. I'm not out to shine my light in front of Jesus. He's already the light. I'm here to shine my light. The lost in a dying world, and to the lost in a dying world, and the testimony of the lost in a dying world, and most of all, my God, the lost in a dying world that grows up under my nose in my own family. And you'd be surprised at the mamas and daddies I've pastored in 30 years has zip influence right inside their own confines of the house in which they live. What causes that? They neglected the salvation that they already had. Some years ago, my dad, before retired, preached a funeral of a lady in the church. He didn't know the lady that much. He just knew she'd come Sunday morning, come Sunday night, come most Wednesday nights. And far as he knew, she's a pretty good person. And so my dad does what all preachers do when you preach a funeral. If you can't say something good about somebody, just be quiet. And all my dad said was this: I appreciate Mrs. So-and-so, and I appreciate her Christian testimony. My daddy was basing that on her coming to church and what he saw at church. Her son in his middle 30s came to my dad at the end of the service and said, "Wow, preacher, I'm glad you told me Mom was a Christian. I didn't know that." He said, "What?" He said, "I knew Mom came to church, but I didn't know Mom was a Christian." And I'll tell you something tonight. You ask me, was my mom a Christian? And I'm going to say, yeah, boy. Yeah. You ask me if my daddy was a Christian, I'd say, yeah, boy. Because if you live in the home with somebody 7 days a week, 24 hours a day, if they're saved and walking with God, I believe somebody's going to know about it. What would cause a parent who goes to church, who claims to be a Christian, have zero influence in their family? I'll tell you why. They didn't mature. They didn't grow. They neglected the salvation that they already had. Influence. I'm not going to name any cities or places, but Dave and I, several years ago, preached in a distant city at a church. And Dave and I, his family, were the youngest people in that service all week. Now, at that time, I was 50 years old. By the way, that ain't old. I'm telling you, 50 ain't bad. I used to have a rule in my church not to hug any of the women under 50 and above 5. But I've had to move that up. Man, them 50-year-old women's looking pretty good for me to say amen. Praise God, my wife is 50. She's pretty. Woo! 50 ain't bad. Dave, how old were you then? About 42? And 42's bad. And his wife is somewhere around there. Well, you're over 21. I'll do that right now, sister. Don't lie in the house of God. We were the youngest people there outside of his children. Me and Dave went out to eat one night, and I said, "Dave, this bothers me. And I don't mean the oldest, youngest people there by 10 years. I don't mean by 15 years. I mean 25 years or more. There were no young families in that church. There were no young teenagers in that church. There were no little toddlers in that church." And I said to Brother Dave, I said, "Dave, dear God, if something don't happen in this church right here in 5 more years, they'll have to close it down." I was shocked. so burdened. I was so burdened. The next day, a friend of mine who pastors in Raleigh, North Carolina, I went over to eat lunch with him, and I was sharing it with him, my burden at that church day when I was preaching it. And my friend said this to me. He said, "Joe, you go back tonight, and you get there early, and you talk to those people that are there. Find out about their families." He said, "You're going to find they've got children. You're going to find they've got grandchildren. You're going to find they got nieces and their nephews." And he said, "Brother Joe, what you're going to find is this: not only did that church not reach the next generation, not only did they not reach the next generation in their community," he said, "but you're going to find the saddest of all, they not even reached the next generation that grew up right under the bridge of their nose." Well, this got a hold of me the other day. I was reading about Jesus' end time prophecies. And of all the people Brother David he could have referred to, he said, "As it was in the days of Noah, and as it was in the days of Lot." Out of all the people he could have alluded to, "As it was in the days of Noah, and as it was in the days of Lot." Both of them lived in a wicked society. Both of them tried to be a Christian in a Christless world. But you know, there between Noah and Lot, some in that door shut on that ark, and the lightning flashed and the thunder rolled, and the moon and the sun hid behind the gray storm clouds as that ark reeled and rocked in the judgment. I see a little candle flicking in that ark, and I see Noah as he looks through that dim lit ark. He sees his wife, and he sees his boys, and he sees their wives. Somebody may say, "Oh, I tell you, Brother Noah, he didn't build no mega boat. He didn't get much done." I mean, what he did do, he got the most precious thing to him, was his own family on the inside of that ark. Boy, look at Lot. Oh God, he lost the most precious thing known to man. He's got son-in-laws dead in the fires of Sodom. He's got a wife dead on the outside of the city. And he's got two daughters that get him drunk and commit incest and bring two nations into the world. That's been a plague and an eyesore to the people of God for thousands and thousands of years. I want to tell you, Lot lost a lot, brother. And I believe in the end time, there's going to be two types of end time Christians. Some will get their family in, and some will lose their family. And I'm telling you this tonight, there's nothing in the world any greater than mama being saved, and daddy being saved, and junior being saved, and sissy being saved. In the name of God and Jesus and the Holy Ghost, let's at least reach the generation, honey, that's right under the bridge of our nose. Limited influence. You say, "Now, preacher, I've tried, and I've prayed, and I've studied, and I've brought them to church." Well, you got to realize this. They got a will, they got a choice, and they got to make it because they want to. You know why Noah's kids is on that ark? Because he built it, and he owned the door. But the reason why they're on that ark is because they decided to get on that ark. They could have went to hell with the rest of that Antediluvian world. But at least daddy made a provision. At least daddy made a way. At least daddy gave them an opportunity. And let me say this tonight. You may bring your kids to church. You may raise them in church. And they may come to a place where they spit on you, spit on God, and walk away. But at least you can lay your head on your pillow and say, "I provided a place. At least I gave them an opportunity." That's why you need to stay in a red hot, old fashioned church just like this. Keep them in an atmosphere that's conducive for God to get a hold of them and God to change their life. Don't you get mad at that preacher and roll up to some outfit that don't preach the word of God. Don't you do that. Keep them in the birthing room. Keep them in the incubator. Stay with God. Stay with God. Give them at least an opportunity. Saddest thing I see pastoring our church right now is a generation between 25 and 41 that's giving their children everything but Jesus. I don't know how the rest of you pastors are. I can't compete with ball, cheerleading, Boy Scouts, travel ball, family reunions, beauty pageants, anything. You You say, well, I bet your kids didn't have no fun. My son turned down the scholarship to go play baseball because God called him to preach. You say, your kids probably didn't have any fun. My daughter just graduated with a degree in law, having the time of her life, arguing in front of a judge. I'm just going to name me anymore. Can I get a witness? Our kids had fun. Man, we played ball, she cheerleaded, we went on vacation. I believe every preacher ought to have a number one commandment. We going on vacation. Take your ministry and hang it on the city limit sign. Get your youngins, go have a time, and come and pick it back up. It'll be there when you get back. Man, I love it. We had the time of our life. We had fun. But buddy, when Sunday morning rolled around, we put the fun away and headed out to the house of God. And I'm going to shake one more bush while I'm at it. I get so tired of hearing these even independent Baptist churches say, we're not going to have Sunday night anymore. That's family time. I think what family time is, mama gets your Bible. Daddy gets your Bible. Get you and sissy your Bible. And come into the house of God. And we'll sing Jesus. What a wonderful name. And we'll sing Amazing Grace. And the man of God will preach. And I think anybody want to be real family time when one wakes you up at night and says, mama, mama, take me back down out of that church.
My family, and I appreciate that. My family loves you, and I want you to like me. I want Miss Wendy to like me. Brother Crabtree, I've been preaching to you when you've always been skinny, but I've been preaching to you forever when you had a half a stripe in your pajamas, and I love your family, and I want you to your lightning. And I love you people in Statesville, you North Carolina people. I called my wife today. I said, pack your bags, baby. I've got the place I want to live. I want to live downtown Mooresville, right beside of the Mooresville ice cream store. I wouldn't be surprised if the millennial reign of Christ went right beside that gun shop and right beside that ice cream store that we went to today. Boy, you can't stay on a diet and be around people that love you. Come on, Brother Joe, let's eat this. Come on, Brother Joe, let's eat that. And then just beg you to go in there to that ice cream store. I said, Brother Chris, let's do this. Let's at least pray about it. Let's just, you know, go around the block and pray about it. And Brother Chris, let's do this. Let's just lay a fleece out before God. Let's just lay a fleece out before God. And let's lay a fleece out before God that if there's not a parking space right in the front door, we won't go in. And after 20 times around the block, we found a place and whee! I'll have to confess, he did better than I did. He only ate one scoop, but I had a double decker. Felt something on that gummies. Butter pecan. The reason why he only got one scoop, he lives close enough to go back next week. I'd have to come a long way back there again. Oh man, I'm telling you tonight, I want to reach my family. You want to reach your family. I want Brother Chris to like me. I want you to like me. I want the North Carolina people to like me. Only there's two people tonight, and I want them to like me and love me and respect me more than anybody else on planet Earth. And that's my son, and that's my daughter. What profit a man if he gained the whole world and lose his own soul? Closest thing to our soul and our heart and our own blood is our children. What a shame for you to work with somebody down at the job for 30 years and they not know you're a Christian. What a shame for you to have people you know in your neighborhood for 30 and 40 years and they're surprised when they have your funeral at a church. Had a businessman in our area die, had a large business, had a large family. They weren't a part of our church, but they asked me, they said, can we use your church so there's not a funeral home? There's not a funeral home in the state of Georgia that can accommodate this many people. Can we use your church? And this business had been gracious to us in several areas, and so we allowed them to have that man's funeral in our church. Boy, our church phone rang for two solid days. My little secretary, she was as upset as she could be. She come out, she said, preacher, I can't believe phone calls I'm getting. Why are you having his funeral in there? You need to have it in the strip club. You need to have it in the beer joint. Why are you having his funeral in that church? Is he one of your old church members? And I said, and finally I said, do the Christ-like thing and hang up on him. I thought, dear God, I didn't get calls like that. When they put it in the paper that Reverend J.B. offered had gone to glory. And on Monday night, they were having his funeral service of the Harvest Baptist Tabernacle. Boy, we didn't get no calls like that. It didn't shock anybody that old Brother J.B. laid in state. Hallelujah, my heart. Hey, what a tragedy it would be to go to school with somebody and you die and they come to your funeral and they're shocked to find out you were a Christian. Hey, let's not limit our spiritual growth. Let's not limit our influence. Let's go for God, all the way for God, live for God, hold back nothing. Don't neglect the salvation that we already got. Because we cannot escape a lack of spiritual growth. Limited influence. Let me close with this. How shall we escape? You cannot escape, listen to this, a loss of reward. You can't escape losing your reward if you neglect the salvation that you already have. You see, tonight you can't lose your salvation. There's no such teaching in all the Bible. You're saved forever. You got to go to heaven whether you want to or not. You know, there's people that don't believe in the rapture. If they're saved, what in the world? I mean, can you imagine going in the rapture on the protest? I don't want to go. If you're saved, you are going. The devil knows he can't send you to hell. He knows he can't pull Jesus and the Holy Ghost out of you. So what is he going to do? He's going to take your peace and your joy and your influence and then your reward.
Ladies and gentlemen, tonight, if you could not lose your reward, if that was not a possibility, then we would not be admonished by the apostle, lest we lose our reward. I don't know about you tonight, but when I bow at the feet of Jesus, I sure would love to have something to lay at his feet. I've heard people say this in church, "Oh, Brother Joe, how can I could never repay the Lord for all of his goodness." I know you can't, but what's wrong with trying? Oh, I can never repay him for saving me. I know, but I want to try. I can never thank him enough. I know, so thank him a little. I can never give him enough. Okay? And give him a little. I can never live enough. Okay? Just live a little. Just try to praise him. Try to serve him. Try to be appreciative. Because when you bow at his feet and see him on that throne, believe me, you want to have something to lay at the feet of Jesus. Can you imagine being in heaven your first day? Can you imagine seeing the sights of heaven and hearing the sounds of heaven for the first day? Someone said, "Preacher, pray I'll be able to find Jesus." That will not be any problem at all. On that throne sits the Lamb of God.
Amen.
The light of the city, the cornerstone of the church, the song of the saved, the champion from the cross, the redeemer from Calvary. My Lord, can you imagine? Sitting on that throne surrounded by our green rainbow, symbolizing life eternal, for everlasting and everlasting. Them cherubims flying by, one said holy, other said holy, other said holy. You go, me too. Boy, then the door opens and they start coming from the north and the south and the east and the west, out of every tribe, tongue, and kindred, singing, "Redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Redeemed by the blood of the Lamb." There's not going to be anybody in heaven bragging on being a Baptist and bragging on being a church member and bragging on church membership. They'll be saying, "I'm here because of the blood of my Redeemer. He saved me. He loved me." Can you imagine seeing him who redeemed you by his grace? And you bow at his feet and they're scarred. You look into his eyes and his brows, and they're scarred. He reaches that hand over to wipe the tears away, and his regal robe pulls up on his arm, and his hands are scarred. You look at him and you say, "Oh, Jesus, where did you get all of them scars? Where'd you get all of them marks and wounds?" He looks down at you and said, "I had to do this so you could be here."
Amen.
I just believe you're going to want to say, "I know it. Jesus, this little old reward I got for something I just should have did anyway. This crown I got for just doing what I should have did anyway, I'm really not worthy of it. I want to toss it at your feet." And suddenly come by the thousands laying their crowns at the feet of Jesus. Brother, you talk about a celebration. Can you imagine being there when, hallelujah, the saints of God come walking in and they bow in the crowns at the feet of Jesus? But can you imagine how embarrassed and how we'll feel when they'll say, "What have you got?" And we say, "Nothing, Lord. Nothing, Lord. I trusted you that night. You saved me that night. But I didn't grow and I didn't mature and I neglected my salvation. And I came to you, Lord, empty handed. I don't want to stand before Jesus empty handed and broken hearted." But that's what happens tonight if we neglect the salvation that we already have. Anybody here tonight saved?
Amen.
Know it?
Amen.
And glad?
Amen.
Then live like it.
Amen.
Pray like it.
Amen.
Serve like it.
Amen.
shout like it. Honor God like it.
Amen.
Don't neglect the salvation that you already have. This little song, by and by, when I look on his face, beautiful face, thorn riven face, by and by, when I look on his face, I wish I had given him more, 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 more of my life than I ever gave before. By and by, when I look on his face, I wish I had given him more. My sermon may not make you want to do that tonight. This choir music may not make you want to do that tonight. But when you see the shining face of Jesus, you'll have wished you'd have given him more. Our Heavenly Father, we love you tonight. Thank you, Lord, not only for the blessing of salvation, but thank you for the responsibility of salvation. Lord, would you help us tonight to go farther and go deeper and draw closer. Lord, help us to pray, study, walk with God, meditate, witness, live, praise, grow, mature, add to our faith. God, please don't let us live our Christian life and not leave behind any influence. God, save us from ourselves. And Lord, we'll have our testimony and some influence of these last days. Lord, you said if the church loses its savor, it'll be cast out and trodden under the foot of men. And Lord, I believe that's why we got a government, a society that just tramples all over the church, because so many of us have lost our salt, our savor. Help us tonight, Lord, not to neglect what you've done for us, but help us to go far with you. We love you tonight. In Jesus' name, with thanksgiving, we pray. Amen. Pastor, you come to the service.
Stand our feet tonight, if you would. What kind of influence tonight are you going to make on your children, on your grandchildren? What kind of influence tonight are you going to be on those you work with, all those you're acquainted with? Certainly don't need to add anything to that. I think that was just plain. I've always said this, and I believe it. How can we expect others around us to live for God if they don't see God in us? And I want to say tonight, it is hopeless without surrendering to Him. Well, James is going to sing for us tonight. You just smile the Lord this evening. Couldn't help to think about Grayson. And I know his grandparents love Jesus. Mom, Dad love Jesus. I'm glad he had a mama last night that didn't bother him. Didn't bother her. She had to bring him back to church as she already laid down. Because that's the most important thing in their lives. You know, it's all said and done, my life, the older I've got. I am so thankful I had a mama that took me.
There's a voice calling me from an old rugged tree, and it whispers, draw closer to me.
Yes.
For whatever it takes. that's what I'll be willing to do. Take the dearest things to me, if that's how it must be, to draw me closer to thee. Disappointments come, lonely days without the sun, if through sorrow more like you I'll become.
I want to do this right before we leave this evening. This is Jubilee and I don't really get in a big hurry this week, but I know you got kids in school and all that. I'm aware of that. But I want them to sing a song for me. And I want to dedicate it to every parent and every grandparent that's done your best in your life to raise your children, as we say it, in the nurture and the admonition of the Lord. The song is simply about a godly heritage. Listen to me, church. This is serious business to me. I'm not just spending time this evening. Listen, let me tell you. We have hundreds of kids coming here every Sunday. Matter of fact, we got kids that beg to come during the week, that have to step over drunkard daddies, absent moms, cussing, drugs, alcohol, filth. Most of the time they're just looking for somebody to love them. But if you're in here tonight, you were raised in a godly home, where Jesus was spoken of often. If you were raised in an old-fashioned church, you ought to thank God for your godly heritage. I want to sing this little song. I want to dedicate this to every mom and dad and to every grandparent that stood the test of time and stayed faithful to God. Brother James, would y'all sing that for me, please? Listen. Here it is, Mom and Dad. Preacher, my youngins out of church. you go by and visit her. Don't tell her I sent you. Don't mention anything about it. But you just go by and visit her. See if you could get her back to church. The greatest joy in my life would have to be that my family's saved and serving God. Sing that second verse, Miss Victoria. Lack of spiritual maturity. See, I don't care how much man lets you down. Jesus never fails. I tell you what you ought to do. You ought to stand in the gap for him.
Yes, preacher. Yes.
You ought to pray for him.